Thanks, Noah. That was a great introduction. I just want to say that if anyone is kind of listening or following the debate in real time on their smartphone, and Trump says something really stupid, feel free to raise your hand, and you know we can interrupt because I really want to know about that. So it's great to be here at Wheaton. I was saying to Noah beforehand that I started my journalism career at the Chicago Tribune 29 years ago. I was a reporter at in the Tribune's Hinsdale Bureau, and I covered Naperville and Aurora, and so I have been here before. And I have to say that I'm really thrilled that all of you are here. I assume that you are here because you have already made up your minds on how you're going to vote, or you are passionate about architecture and urban design, or your professors ordered you to come here and you're DVRing the presidential debate, one of those three. So I want to talk tonight about a narrow subject, gates, that has broad implications for who we are and how we build. And my title, as you can see, Unlocking the Beauty of Gates, really suggests the thesis. And the thesis is that there's a beauty in gates that all too often we fail to recognize. We tend to see these portals instead only as eyesores, as symbols of elitism and exclusion. And to be sure, if we look around our suburban environment, there's ample reason for this widely held and largely negative view of gates. Consider these entrances to gated communities that I'm showing you here. The one on the top is really an architecture critic's dream target. I mean, it wasn't enough that the developers of this subdivision had to have one kind of faux wrought iron gate in the back. They wanted to really make people inside this development feel incredibly secure. And so they had to put in that yellow and black barrier gate in the front of the other gate. It's kind of like they think that ISIS is about to attack their subdivision. And this kind of gratuitous doubling down on security, I think, sends a very forbidding message, which is that this gated community is not the public realm, and you'll only get in if we let you in. So if you think about examples like this, it's easy to associate closed gates with closed minds. And, or worse, as this column on Trayvon Martin suggests, with a dangerous mindset that views outsiders as menacing intruders who should be shot. Okay, so point taken. I don't like gated communities either. But my central idea is that at their best, gates and gateways, like Eero Saarinen's Gateway Arch in St. Louis, which you're seeing here, lend a poetry of their own to acts of passage that form an essential part of our lives as individuals and as parts of something larger than ourselves. In St. Louis, as you can see, the arch commands the vast scale of the Mississippi River and the continent as it celebrates the mass migration of America's westward expansion. Similarly, in Berlin, the Brandenburg Gate is laden with layer upon layer of complex cultural associations. Prussian military victory, Adolf Hitler's rise, Cold War division exemplified, as you can see here, by the Berlin Wall and the infamous Watchtower. It also exemplifies Ronald Reagan's tear down this wall challenge, and today, of course, German reunification. So my argument then is that not all gates are created equal. Those with which I began, the gated community entrances, are ugly, utilitarian, and purely restrictive. Yet other gates can be beautiful and ceremonial. They can delineate our passages through space and time, articulate noble ideals and aspirations, and express the profound power of transitions we make from confinement to freedom, from life to death, or from ignorance to understanding. And for an academic audience gathered near the beginning of the school year, as you are today, there may be no better example of such a gate than the Dexter Gate, one of the 25 gates at Harvard Yard, and the famous quotation that you can see in it. It says, "Enter to grow in wisdom." So today, tonight, I want to explore the broad themes I've sketched out in a talk of four sections. A framework for understanding and evaluating gates, the backstory of Harvard Yard's gates, the urban design and architecture of those gates, and a concluding section on why gates remain relevant today. So first, I want to address a question that you're probably asking yourself, which is, why the hell is the Chicago Tribune's architecture critic so interested in gates, especially the gates of Harvard Yard? I mean, as we all know, Chicago was an architecture capital, you know, Louis Sullivan, Frank Lloyd Wright, Mies van der Rohe, Helmut Jahn, Jeannie Gang. Is there nothing better in Chicago to occupy Blair Kamen? Why is he, you know, spending all this time considering about, thinking about gates? So I just want to tell you my own backstory and how I came upon this passion for gates. In the academic year 2012-2013, I had a Nieman Journalism Fellowship, and that's a journalism fellowship at Harvard where you get to go there for a year, take any classes you want. And when I was there, I was immediately struck by the way that Harvard's gates frame views as well as movement. So for example, you're seeing the slide on the left. This is the Meyer Gate. Aren't we in the Meyer Science Center? So it's probably a different Meyer family, but you can see that, you know, that Meyer Gate is actually framing a view of the Harvard Science Center, which is interesting, given where we're sitting. I was fascinated by the details on the gates, like that beautiful, ornate, wrought iron flower, and I was mystified by other things, like all these fences around Harvard Yard have numbers on them, like this 8 with a circle around it. I didn't understand what that was all about, and then some of the gates had kind of bizarre symbols on them. The one on the lower right, you can see under Harvard's famous Veritas shield, is a pig's face. What was that? I mean, why would you put a pig's face on a gate? So anyway, when the curator of the fellowship asked if anyone wanted to teach a winter session class, that's an 8-day interterm class, on arts journalism, I raised my hand. And I taught this class with two other Nieman fellows, and we really did have a blast teaching the students the fundamentals of journalism, especially journalism Chicago style. Here I am, as you can see, with two of the students, and this is a part of journalism that we call hat and coat. And what hat and coat means is that if it's 20 degrees below zero and a fire breaks out in the South Side, the editor says, "Kamen, hat and coat, get your butt out there to the South Side and go report the story." And so we made the students go out to the gates and count how many people were going through them. And it was only 20 degrees, it wasn't 20 below zero, but you get the idea. We also taught them things like the first commandment of Chicago journalism, which is this famous saying, "When your mother says she loves you, check it out." And that is a saying that really has to do with the need for factual accuracy, something I think that clearly Lester Holt is going to need tonight as he moderates a debate in which one of the participants is a well-documented liar. So, in any event, before long, the students did great work. They each wrote an essay, two essays about the gates. It turned into an ebook and then this book that Noah mentioned. And before long, I was leading tours of gates. This is, you know, a tour of the Harvard gates to the Harvard Club of Boston. And then I really got into it. I started booking expensive overseas flights so I could get my picture taken in front of famous gates. Well, not really. I mean, this was a family vacation on the right, and that was a Tribune assignment on the left, but I did start to really get deeply into this. I even bought a model of Harvard's Dexter Gate, which you see on the left, along with a book. And I mean, the thing is that I wanted to possess the gates, but they wound up possessing me. I really did get into this, and I got so deeply into it that I found out all kinds of stuff about gates that I just never knew before. Now, you all know about the Watergate scandal, right? The famous Watergate scandal that forced Richard Nixon to resign. So you can see here the Watergate, please come in. This is the Watergate complex where the break-in of the Democratic National Committee headquarters occurred, and that was what brought Nixon, created Nixon's resignation. So what's interesting to me is that the name Watergate has become synonymous with any kind of scandal. If there's a scandal, we attach this suffix gate to it, right? So Billy Gate, Deflate Gate, Bridgegate for Chris, with Chris Christie and so on. So what's interesting is that there actually were Watergates centuries ago. And here is one of them. This is the Tower of London. And then at the bottom of the Tower of London, you see this Watergate, which is along the Thames River, and it's called the Traitor's Gate. So if you were, say, Henry VIII's wife, and he thought you were cheating on him, you were shipped on a boat from his palace through the Traitor's Gate at the Tower of London, and in all likelihood, well, I mean, she didn't come out alive, and anyone went through the Traitor's Gate either didn't come out alive or they just didn't come out. So what's interesting is that on the Potomac River in Washington, there is this lock leading into the Potomac River, and that is a Watergate, and that is how the Watergate complex got its name. So it's interesting where obsessions can lead you. Okay. So now that I've bared my obsessive behavior to you, I do want to pose some serious questions, which are these. What should we think of gates? Should we love them? Should we loathe them? Are they anachronisms or are they relevant to how we design cities today? The very question that Noah raised in his introduction. So to answer those questions, I think we need to begin at the beginning, which is where journalists begin, which is to acknowledge facts on the ground and to define terms precisely as an academic would. So let's talk about facts on the ground. Gates are ubiquitous. From the Taj Mahal gates, which you see on the upper left, to the Brandenburg Gate, to the Nanjing gates in the Nanjing City Wall in China, to the Chicago Stockyards Gate, where there is a champion steer memorialized in the gable atop the gate. People have built gates for millennia and for reasons that transcend geography and cultural distances. They build them for protection, for control, to announce treasured precincts, and to symbolize the power of those who built them. Gates are so widespread that it can be said without much exaggeration that there are three certainties in life: death, taxes, and gates. We encounter gates even in death at the gateways to cemeteries like Mount Auburn Cemetery, the famous cemetery in Cambridge, Massachusetts, this wonderful Egyptian revival gate. And then once we're through those gates, we encounter even more gates. As you can see here, private burial plots for families are demarcated with walls and gateways or with gates, as you see on the lower right. Celebrities are particularly fond of gates. Besides keeping out their yammering fans who want autographs or selfies, these gates serve the function of announcing the celebrity's identity, as if to sound the opening notes of a musical composition, which is very appropriate for Graceland and Elvis Presley's home. In a similar fashion, Stephen King's gates, which you see on the right, with their bats and spiders, rather comically rendered, playfully trumpet his success as a writer of horror fiction. Yet Gates can deceive as well as reveal, nowhere more so than at the infamous gate to the Auschwitz concentration camp and the false promise uttered by its words in German, Arbeit macht frei, work will set you free. It was no accident that photographs of Pope Francis's visit to Auschwitz captured him passing through this gate. Far more than the buildings behind it, the gate has come to symbolize the very real horrors that Hitler and the Nazis visited upon 6 million murdered Jews. So the point is that gates don't just physically control the entry to treasured or terrifying places. For better and for worse, they are cultural signifiers that represent the essence of those places. Now, there's a reason that gates have such deep cultural significance. They have been with us, seemingly, from the beginning of time. In the ancient world, as this map of Jerusalem reveals, they were a frequent part of everyday experience, so they provided convenient and concrete fodder for vivid metaphors and myths. One of the most memorable of those stories evokes a much-quoted line from Jesus in the New Testament book of Matthew, chapter 19, verse 24. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Is that a verse that you're familiar with? Okay. For years, people speculated that the origin of this metaphor was the needle gate, which I am showing a representation of here. And by the way, I have no idea who this woman is. I just stole this picture off the internet. But you can see that it's a very low gate. And as the legend goes, when the main city gate closed at night, the driver of a camel bearing goods would have to remove the packages, then force the camel to get down on its knees and pass through the gate. The story even made its way to a relief sculpture, which you see here. See the kneeling camel? This is a relief sculpture in a church in Dortmund, Germany. And the story also made its way, as many of you probably know, into the lessons of Sunday school teachers, who taught that a rich man had to get rid of his baggage, his worldly possessions, and before he could enter heaven. Fascinating. Now, there's just one problem with the needle gate story. Some scholars now say it isn't true, but it is a great story, so I didn't want to pass it along. We do know this much for certain. Gates have shaped our sense of time as well as space. In the Roman world, the two-headed Janus was the god of beginnings and transitions of doors and gates. Janus could simultaneously look forward to the future or backward to the past. His name forms the root of our month, January, the door to the new year, when we ponder the last year and anticipate the next one to come. Today, of course, Janus-faced means deceitful or two-faced, and that gets to something fundamental about gates. Their beauty is ambiguous. It's inextricably intertwined with the reality that one person is controlling how another person uses space. Control is the key word. So consider, too, the British usage of the verb gate, to confine to a campus or dormitory. So I think you're a generation that grew up reading Harry Potter, yes? Okay. So you can imagine the headmaster at Hogwarts saying, "Behave badly, Harry Potter, and you will be gated for the weekend." In the real world, as the prisoners in penitentiaries know, gates, the kind like this, that close with a sickening thud, are designed as much to keep people in as to keep them out. So how we regard gates, then, really depends greatly on the position from which we regard them. Are we on the outside wanting to get in, or on the inside wishing to get out? The importance of the gate is suggested by the power of its keeper. he or she who controls the gate controls access to the city or to freedom or to, say, a meeting with the president, which is greatly coveted. That's why we still use the word gatekeeper to describe, as in the slide on the right, the mother who is the nutritional gatekeeper for her family, or, I love this slide on the left, the St. Peter at the Pearly Gates. This is the 21st century digital age version of St. Peter. He is asking the new arrival for username and password, otherwise, you know, straight back down. All right, so we know that gates are about control and ambiguity, but my job as a critic is to distinguish between what's good and what isn't, what's has merit and what's mediocre. So how should we distinguish between the good and the bad gates? And I suggest that we consider them through three lenses, as objects, as places, and as vessels of identity. Whoops, sorry. So here's a striking example of a gate as an object. This is the University of Chicago's Cobb Gate, originally the Hull Gate. It was designed by architect Henry Ives Cobb and has served since 1897 as the entrance to the U of C's main quad. Now, this fanciful Gothic gate is a focal point due to its combination of muscularity and delicacy, seriousness and playfulness. Its mythical figures, known as grotesques, possess a rich symbolic value. This one, the ferocious, outward-looking grotesque, is said to represent the ultimate kind of gatekeeper, the college admissions officer. And the ascending grotesques, okay, so that's where the admissions officer is. The ascending grotesques, 1, 2, and 3, are said to represent first, second, and third year students. And then the triumphant fourth year student has made it through the gauntlet and is, you know, like Rocky at the top of the steps, proudly proclaiming that he is a holder of a degree, or she. Yet the best gates are not simply objects. By virtue of their ability to direct the flow of pedestrians, to serve as funnels for that flow, as a scientist might say, they are ideal points for merchants, beggars, demonstrators, anyone with a point of view or something to sell. And this gate on the top, the Damascus Gate in Jerusalem, is a very good example. It's a frequent venue for an Arab market and also for demonstrations, some of which have ended violently. We see this gathering function around gates also here in one of the Harvard Yard gates. This is the one with the pig's face on it, and that is a representation, I should tell you, of one of the Harvard fraternity-like organizations called the Porcellian Club, which is sort of a fancy Latin word for having to do with a pig, so that's why they put the pig's face up there. But you can see how the gate is U-shaped and how there's little benches on it, so it allows people to kind of gather in this plaza and also wait for the bus as it's coming by. So here we see that the gate is a place, not just a passageway from point A to point B. And finally, gates are powerful. I should say that another example of this gate as place, not just passageway, is another famous gate from Jerusalem. This is the Golden Gate, which gave its name to San Francisco's Golden Gate Bridge. And the first biblical mention of gates, of city gates, okay, actually, I mean, this is, you know, a school where people take religion seriously, right? Can anyone name, I'm just curious, can anyone name the first biblical mention of a city gate? No, okay. It's in Genesis chapter 19, verse 1, when Lot is said to be in a city gate waiting to receive angels sent to the wicked city of Sodom. Interesting. But the preposition in is interesting because he's not at the gate, he's in the gate, and with this representation of the Golden Gate, you can see why gates actually contained places inside of them where people met. Also, as you may know, trials were held, the round gates at the edges of the city. And so, again, this idea that the gate is a place and not a passageway. Sorry for the repetition. Gates, finally, are symbols of identity, of institutions, of nations, and of conflict, as the Brandenburg Gate reveals. This gate was built in 1791 as a key entry into the city of Berlin, and it's elegantly proportioned neoclassical base is topped by something called a quadriga, which you see in the slide on the upper left, and that is a chariot pulled by four horses driven by a goddess of victory. The Iron Cross was added later on after Germany, Prussia, I should say, defeated France, and the gate was brought back to Paris, from Paris, where Napoleon had captured it, back to Berlin. And after World War II, of course, the gate and the Berlin Wall came to represent the division of the city and the tensions of the Cold War. So it was no coincidence, as you see in the other images, that in 1987, Ronald Reagan, the master of presidential stagecraft, chose this gate as the setting for a speech in which he famously told the Soviet leader, Mikhail Gorbachev, to tear down this wall. But as you can see in the text, before Reagan uttered those famous words, he uttered these: "Mr. Gorbachev opened this gate," and that too was met with thunderous applause. So it's interesting that today, as shown by the lighting of world landmarks after the Paris terrorist attacks, in the tricolor of the French flag, the Brandenburg Gate really has come to symbolize the German nation. It's not, that symbol is not the Reichstag, the equivalent of our Congress. It's not the skyline of Frankfurt, the equivalent of Lower Manhattan. It's the Brandenburg Gate. It is really on a par with such iconic structures as the Sydney Opera House, Christ the Redeemer in Rio, and One World Trade Center in New York. And it's, as you can see, the gate is where people gathered after the Paris terror attacks. So this gate really works on three interrelated levels that I've been discussing. It's a beautiful aesthetic object, it's an urban place, and it's a conveyor of national identity. Okay, so let's shift back across the Atlantic and to the gates that I've come to know, the Harvard Yard Gates. They are equally impressive as the Brandenburg Gate, yet they derive their power from the fact that they are an ensemble, a group of gates, in which the whole is more than the sum of its individual parts. And as you can see from this aerial, Harvard's campus is different from Wheaton's. Wheaton's is suburban. Harvard's is embedded in the urban fabric of Cambridge, Massachusetts. It's kind of this, the campus, the Harvard Yard, which you see here, is a kind of oasis within that dense urban fabric. And surrounding the yard on its perimeter are 25 gates on Massachusetts Avenue here, Broadway and Cambridge Street here, and Quincy Street here. Here's a map, which is in the book. You can see the gates delineated. And they were built in two campaigns. One was around the turn of the last century, 1903. The other was during the Depression. And the building of them has continued until fairly recent times. This is the most recent one. You can see 1997. That's the year in which it was built. It commemorated the 25th anniversary of women living in Harvard Yard dorms. And it also commemorated or honored Anne Bradstreet, who was the first published poet in the American colonies. Now, I said to you at the beginning that I was mystified by these numbers on the gates and why they were there. So it turns out that Harvard has a tradition of class-based giving. And you can see where that tradition began. Harvard has a building, a Victorian Gothic building called Memorial Hall. it was erected as a memorial to the Harvard men who died in the Union cause during the Civil War. So different classes donated money for stained glass windows by Lewis Comfort Tiffany and other great artists. And you can see here that the class of 1844 donated the money for this stained glass window. So likewise, with the gates of Harvard Yard, the class-based giving continued, and in this case, the class of 1908 was the class that donated the money for the fencing and gates, and it's commemorated here. At the same time, several of the gates recognized both classes of alumni and individual donors who gave large sums of money for the gates. And this one honors both. You can see that the major donor was a fellow named Robert Bacon. He was in the class of 1880, and one of his classmates was Theodore Roosevelt, President of the United States. Bacon had a very distinguished career. He served as a U.S. ambassador, and Roosevelt tapped him to be Secretary of State at one point. This is another gate, now demolished, and it recognized Thomas Dudley, a Harvard man who sailed on the Arabella with the Puritans. You can see Dudley is represented right here. He helped found Harvard. He governed the Massachusetts Bay Colony. And this was a very quirky gate. It has, you can see this asymmetrical profile in which one tower is taller than the other. It has a clock tower. And what's amazing about this gate is that it costs the equivalent of, I don't know, $400,000 today. I mean, it was really expensive. And it was dedicated in 1915, and only 32 years later, it was torn down to make way for Harvard's modernist library, the Lamont Library. So this gate came down, and it was replaced by that gate, which I think it's fair to say is a tragedy. These gates are about as, you know, minimal as they come, not very impressive. Okay, Harvard Yard, it's worth noting, is a privately owned public space. And what that means is that we, the public, are free to enter Harvard Yard, but Harvard controls the yard and has the right to limit access to it. That's what the university did in 2011 when the Occupy movement put up a tent camp right here within sight of the statue of John Harvard. And access to the yard gates was controlled. In order to get through the gates, you had to show an ID, and many of the gates were locked. And this really upset people in Cambridge, Massachusetts, because they cut through Harvard Yard. They use it as a shortcut to get from, you know, point A to point B. And this was a classic example of, you know, big bad Harvard throwing its weight around, forcing everybody to act in the way that it wants them to act. But I would argue that this moment was significant, not because it was typical, but rather because it was exceptional, and because it caused people to lose sight of what the gates give the campus and its environs. And that is a gift that's considerable. Now, interestingly, we are all part of the greater Chicago area. The gift of the Harvard gates began with this man, a Chicagoan. There he is, Samuel Johnston, Harvard class of 1855. He was a real estate entrepreneur and financier. And if you've ever been to the Lincoln Park Zoo and you've seen a statue of Shakespeare right outside the Lincoln Park Zoo, he was the donor for that, as well as the gate I'm about to show you. So now, I'm particularly thrilled to talk about Johnston because I think, as everyone in this room knows, all architectural roads pass through Chicago, right? And I really like to point that out to especially anyone from New York or Delaware, say. So that's true at Harvard as well. In 1886, which was the 250th anniversary of Harvard. Harvard is that old that they were celebrating their 250th anniversary in 1886. Samuel Johnson was present and he walked through what were then the gates of Harvard Yard. And this is what they were. There was a post and rail fence and these two simple granite pillars. Johnson, a true Chicagoan who believed, like Daniel Burnham, that we should make no little plans, thought that this enclosure, these gates, were inadequate for America's first university and one that was aspiring to be one of the great universities of the world. So when he died, just a few years later, he left $10,000 in his will to Harvard for the construction of a new gate. And here it is, right? So there's what the gate, that was what the entrance to Harvard looked like for like 200 years. And in 1889, this was the new entrance to Harvard. So you can see that this is a U-shaped gate. It has a central carriage gate in the center. There are foot gates, in other words, for pedestrians on the side. And the gate blends beautifully with the colonial buildings on the flanks. This is Massachusetts Hall, Harvard's oldest building from 1720. And this building with a cupola is Harvard Hall, also an 18th century building. So Charles McKim, the architect, wanted to make it seem like the gate had been there from the beginning of time, which is a very American thing, right? I mean, we like our history, instant. So McKim did this in a fascinating way. He blended, he actually wandered the brickyards of Boston, and he found these overburned bricks. They were called culls, and they created this very varied texture of brick. So you can see here, right, that there's red brick, gray brick, tan brick, all sorts of different colors, green a little bit here. And this kind of very variegated type of brick matched the brickwork of the colonial buildings. So it was like, instant history. He rendered symbols of authority in the gates, right? Here's Harvard's shield. And interestingly, you see the Veritas. Everybody knows, right, that Veritas means truth. But you will also see that it says Christo et, I can't remember the Latin there, but it's Christ and Church. Truth for Christ and Church, I think, was their motto. What I also like about this gate is that it contains Johnson's personal seal. And you can see his name rendered in Latin. And then I do love this part. This is, in Latin, Chicago. And very few other cities can, well, I guess since Cincinnati, where he was born, is also represented there. But I do like the fact that Chicago is the most prominently displayed. The gate is extraordinary for its brickwork, for its symbols, and also for its ironwork. You can see the cross, which represents Harvard's commitment to training ministers. You can see 1636, the year of the university's founding, and in this little shield, 1889, which is the year of the gate's completion. Now, like most architects, McKim blew the budget. Johnston donated $10,000, as I told you. McKim needed an extra $6,000 to pay for this great ironwork, and he got it from Marion Alice Appleton, from the very wealthy Appleton family of Boston. Now, Mrs. Appleton is recognized with her initials displayed in reverse on the shield on the back of the gate, right here. Now, why, you would wonder, would McKim put the initials in reverse, right? Well, I think it makes sense because when you look from Harvard Yard outward, 1636 is also in reverse, right? So McKim, like all architects, finicky, a perfectionist, put Mary Alice Appleton's initials in reverse as well. So what looks to be AAM is actually MAA. And if you're ever at Harvard, you can impress your friends with this really esoteric, kind of thing. And it's kind of like knowing, the Da Vinci Code. But it is really a reminder, I think, that gates have a special power, which is a narrative power. They have a power to tell a story, to bind people together by articulating a shared history, one that transcends time. Okay, yet like all architecture, these gates, the Harvard gates, reflect the spirit and circumstances of the time in which they were built. Okay, now that era, the late Gilded Age of the 1880s and 1890s, saw cities like Chicago choking on their own industrial growth. This is, right, if you're in urban studies, you have to have seen this slide before. This is State and Madison, the world's busiest corner. This is the so-called gray city of skyscrapers and soot and pollution. And of course, as you all know, this is the counterpoint to that sort of urban growth, the white city of Daniel Burnham's World's Columbian Exposition of 1893 and its search for order. Well, Cambridge, Massachusetts was not immune from encroaching urbanization. As you see in this postcard eye view of Harvard's campus, streetcars were running through, running down Massachusetts Avenue. They were clanging, they were barreling, and they were upsetting the contemplative groves of academe that were found within. So in response, architects proposed grandiose city beautiful plans like this one, which you see in the top, which called for a monumental boulevard extending from the Charles River all the way up to Massachusetts Avenue to be completed by a triumphal gateway. Well, the boulevard was never built, but the gateway was. This is the Morgan Gate, a really spectacular, enormously scaled gate, which leads to Widener Library, the great library of Harvard. It's kind of overscaled. If any of you have ever been to Massachusetts Avenue, you know that it's a lot like, the scale is a lot like downtown Naperville, you know, Main Street. It's a bunch of little shops. And then there's this enormous, grandiose gate there. And it's kind of too big for its own good. And part of the reason is that it has that posture, that kind of out of place posture, is that it was supposed to complete this boulevard that was never built. So, as these blueprints reveal, and I should say that, you know, for all of you digital age types who think that don't know, I mean, there really were blueprints once, they really were blue. It wasn't just, you know, you didn't just whip up a drawing on a CAD machine. You can really see how McKim, Mead, and White, the architects, planned these gates very carefully as an ensemble. Here's the gate I just showed you, the Morgan Gate. Here it is again. You can see that McKim planned these sister gates as little flankers around it. This is the Dexter Gate, the one that says enter to grow in wisdom. And here is its sister gate, the Class of 1889 gate. Both of them have these striped profiles of brick and stone. So what happens is that the gates form a kind of scrim around Harvard's architecturally very pluralistic, painfully pluralistic campus. You can see one of them here, another one of them here, the Porcellian Gate, the one with the pig. You can also see the incredibly eclectic jumble of Harvard's buildings, right? Colonial, neocolonial, Victorian, Boston Granite style. I think it's fair to say that Harvard has always had too much money and not enough of a clear idea of what to do with it. So the gates, from the perspective of the pedestrian along Massachusetts Avenue, kind of form this unifying scrim that they fool you into thinking that it's actually an architecturally unified campus, when in reality, as this slide shows, it isn't. The gates also serve a fascinating function, which is that, like many quadrangular campuses, the buildings like Lehman Hall, which you see here, turn inward toward the quadrangle, and they turn their backs to the street. There's no door on this building, right? Even though it has pilasters and other decoration, it's essentially faceless. So the gates really form the face of the university. They have the kind of human scale, literally right here, as you can see with this gate, the class of 1857 gate, a human scale and a sense of entrance that the buildings lack. Okay. At a more granular level of architectural detail, you can see in this blueprint that the gates work equally well at the level of architectural detail. Here's one prototypical gate, and you can see here that the gates are very much part of an enclosure. Gate in the center, fence on the sides. And you see what this yields. Good proportions in the posts, beautiful scroll work that leads up to this lantern, this wonderful, delicate ornament of a flower. I mean, imagine a blacksmith hammer, you know, taking wrought iron and making it into this flower. It's incredible to think about. What's also incredible and rather sad is that this gate has a building behind it now. It was dedicated around 1903. Then Harvard decided that it wanted more dorms. So the dorms were built, the gate was locked, and it's essentially been a fence ever since, having no function but just to ornament the exterior of the yard. So the gates work on other levels. Architecturally, you can see the way they've been beautifully detailed. Here are spear-tip finials, right? The classic militaristic touch, going back to the defensive wall fortification idea. But look at the way the architects create this transition of this volute, this scroll. I mean, they could have just had the spear-tip finials slam into the post, but they create this beautiful transition into the post. Likewise, this gate, which I love, is raised like an eyebrow, which lets you look at the beautiful blue gable of this colonial era chapel, Holden Chapel, which, so the chapel and its decoration is kind of like a piece of Wedgwood china, right? It's that blue and white, really beautiful and delicate. And the gate really matches that. It frames it and it matches it at the same time. There are other fascinating features about the gates. They are both militaristic, as I mentioned, with the spear-tip finials, and naturalistic. They don't simply enclose the yard, they take its pastoral qualities and extend them out onto the street. Here's one example, an urn, I'll get it. An urn, which is topped by a ram's head. And this gentle ram is chewing on a vine. A really wonderful, delicate detail. The fencing of the gates, I think, is also important to point out. It is fencing, not a wall. And so it allows you to see through into the yard. And such beautiful works of sculpture as this one, Henry Moore's large four-piece reclining figure. So overall then, as we see in this comparison of Harvard Yard and then the Boston Common, it's really a very different picture than the locked gates with which I began. The yard, like the common, is an oasis of green space in a crowded city. It's a privately owned public space that is more public than private. You can walk through it. Even if you're walking around it, you can sample its pastoral qualities. It's characterized more by visual transparency and human scale than forbidding walls and expressions of elitism. So on a spectrum of private versus public, I would say the yard has more in common with the Boston Common than with the gates with which I began, the gates of the gated communities. Okay, so where does this leave us today? What, if any, value do these gates, which had their origins in ancient and medieval times, have in the modern world? Is building new gates progressive, or is it an act of cultural regression? So my answer is that, as in everything in architecture, it really all depends on the context, the circumstances, and our changing human needs. Think of the view of Chicago that confronts the traveler returning to O'Hare. So we have a relentlessly gridded city where the landscape is pancake flat, and the blocks roll on with numbing regularity. Sounds pretty bleak, I know. I do love Chicago. But you know what it's like, right? So in a landscape like that, civic gateways like this one can serve a significant role. They can break down and punctuate space, rescuing it from anonymity and infusing it with identity. These are the Division Street gateways, which were built in the 1990s. They are a pair of portals that sweep over Division Street, a very wide street, and they celebrate the Puerto Rican identity of many of the people who live along Division Street in this stretch. They're fascinating. They weigh each 45 tons, and yet they look, they're made out of steel, and yet they look light as a feather, like a flag flapping in the wind. So these gates are not just striking objects, but shapers of space, of a place, I should say, and expressions of identity. Here's another example of the relevance of gateways, right? You all are nodding, you all know this. The Wrigley Building and the Tribune Tower forming the gateway to the retail street of North Michigan Avenue. Now, you may not know this. This gateway did not happen by accident. When the Michigan Avenue Bridge was built in 1920, a Chicago architect, Andrew Ribori, dreamed up something of the very sort that we have today. He came up with this scheme, which you can see, the North Michigan Avenue development, looking south from the bridge. Well, I guess I'm wrong. But there actually are, he could have flipped it in the other direction, and there actually are two towers there now that form a gateway from the north going south. So his idea was that buildings should form gateways. They should be kind of gatehouses. And that's exactly what we have today, south of the bridge, and with the 333 North Michigan building and the London House. And I'm sorry I don't have slides of them here, but it's the same thing very much as Tribune and Wrigley. These are the four great 1920s towers that frame the Michigan Avenue Bridge. Here's another example at a nearby university, Northwestern. This is Northwestern's Weber Arch. It is only 5 years old. You can see how the stone pillars of the Weber Arch match the architecture of the historic building behind them. You can see the laser-cut letters in Gothic, Northwestern University. And you can see how this gate has become part of a tradition. When freshmen come to Northwestern, they are ushered through this gate by the university band. And that gate has become so synonymous with the university that the football team has actually, in certain of their helmets, custom helmets, they have put a representation of the gate on the back of the helmets. It has become that much of a symbol of the university in just 5 years, which is fairly amazing. Now, then there is the ultimate contemporary gate, which you all know, Anish Kapoor's Cloud Gate in Millennium Park. Also known as the Bean, Cloud Gate transcends the ambiguity associated with gates, in part because it's a standalone object, not part of an enclosure with walls or fences. Yet it is indeed a gateway, although what it is leading to is not entirely clear. Perhaps the destinations are fun, joy, and a sense of wonder. I think you all know the drill at this gate, right? You say, wow, you take a selfie, you go below, you take another selfie at the in the wonderful funhouse domed reflections, and then you come out the other side where the sky and the skyline fuse in this single spectacular panorama. Maybe it takes a large-scale sculpture like this to remind us that gates don't have to repel people, they can actually attract them and create focal points for civic life. So perhaps you notice that each of the examples I just showed you are not gates, strictly speaking. Unlike the Harvard gates, they don't have swinging metal doors set on hinges. They do not restrict movement, yet they do form gateways. Not gates, but gateways. And that, I think, opens important possibilities for our discussion of the contemporary relevance of this whole business. A gateway, after all, is less restrictive than a gate. It channels motion, but does not control it. As the definition says, a gateway simply provides access or entry to a place. So if there's a larger lesson here, a lesson that transcends gates and extends to all architecture, I think it has to do with the importance of the phrase making an entrance. Now think about those words. You've heard them a million times, and typically they're used to describe a larger-than-life figure who bursts into a room and sweeps everyone off their feet. That's Hollywood, right? The red carpet or the Academy Awards. But in the real world, architects make an entrance all the time. They make entrances to our buildings, and ideally they make them memorable and iconic, like Henry Hobson Richardson did in this iconic arched entryway to Glessner House. Or architects make entrances not just to houses or to cities, but to nations, as exemplified by the Golden Door, the gateway to America at Ellis Island. So here's the bigger picture. Far from being ugly and elitist and the monsters they're often made out to be, gates and gateways have an important role to play in the design of the human habitat. They can sound the opening notes in the architectural symphony of a city or a university. They are powerful symbols, as I am reminding you with this image of the Brandenburg Gate, of belonging. They are signifiers of history. They are vivid expressions of the transitions through space and time that form an essential part of human experience. It is human nature, it would appear, to build gates and gateways. The question is not whether we should build them, but how. So to conclude then, in the spirit of what is happening in real time at a presidential debate that we're not watching, I would say no to gated communities and especially to walls that shut out the world. But I would say yes to gateways, especially those that enrich our lives as works of art, that shape a sense of place, and that form emblems of identity. That's the profound lesson that I learned from the gates of Harvard Yard. Thank you. Thank you very much.
We have some time for Q&A.
Yeah, of course. I'm happy to take it. If anyone has questions or an update on the debate. Anyone? Yeah.
I was wondering if Leah can teach social ethics, arts, and humanitarian. And I really like what you're saying about it's human nature for gates and not letters, but how.
Right.
And I've heard whispers in the biology world, and I hate to go more into it, the human cell is actually the membrane around the cell that controls the life of the cell, maybe even more than the DNA. So when I see these gates going out from the yard, I'm thinking, that's where it's all at. So my question to you is, from your perspective, who do you think should be responsible in forming these things? Is it architects? Is it someone else? And then after that, who's accountable for how it plays out?
Right. So the question is, who should be responsible for forming gates, and afterwards, who should be accountable for seeing how it plays out? So one part of the, let me take the second part of the question first. It's a part of the story that I didn't tell you because I didn't want to go too long. Harvard has mistreated many of its gates. Many of these gates are locked unnecessarily. They're poorly maintained. It's like they have this abundance of riches and they take it for granted. I mean, most universities would kill to have one of these gates. Harvard has 25 and they really haven't treated all of them with the care and respect that they deserve. In a sense, they've broken the contract with the alumni who gave money for the gates, right? I mean, think of it, you know, you donate money and you know, you expect your gate to have some you know, TLC, right? And then the university, you know, lets it go to seed. Okay, so who should have a responsibility for building these things? I think that, again, it depends on the context. At a university, it can be the administration and the faculty. They can serve as the client. Ideally, the administration would consult faculty like you, and they would work with architects or landscape architects to create gateways that are, you know, both emblems of place, but also not forbidding. If it's, I mean, essentially what you need is enlightened leaders, enlightened clients. Because as I said, not all gates are created equal. I mean, you can put up gates, but they can be like the gated community gates, or they can be like the Harvard gates. It costs money. It requires great artistry. It requires a vision that needs to be sustained over decades. I mean, it took Harvard a good, you know, 50 years to encircle the yard, and really a century, more than a century, to complete it. So you need, I mean, there's an old saying, good architecture is impossible without good clients. So whether, you know, someday you may hire an architect to build your house, or you may be running a business, and you may be the client, and you will have as much power as the architect in determining the quality of, the enduring quality of, hopefully, what you build, whether it's a gate or a park bench or a church or a, you know, whatever. So that's really important. You know, you can't have a good work of architecture without a good client. And of course, a generous client is helpful as well, as we know from the lesson of the Johnson Gate, where Mrs. Appleton kicked in $6,000 when McKim ran short of money. She was his sister-in-law, by the way. That it helps to have a rich uncle or a rich sister-in-law. Anyway. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Could you talk about the intersection of critique with function, aesthetics, symbolism, how it relates when you critique a gate?
Okay. So the question is, how does a critic relate the different strands of function, critique, and symbolism and aesthetics in looking at a gate, right? It's not different from doing all those things in a building. You look at a building through different lenses. Is it beautiful as an object? Why or why not? Does it convey some meaning that extends beyond itself? How well does it convey it? You know, so like, does it give a sense of delight? I mean, there's a, you know, Vitruvius, the great Roman writer, elucidated criteria for architecture that I think still has meaning today. He said, he talked about firmness, commodity, and delight. Firmness was the quality of whether a building was built well. Commodity was how it functioned. Did it fulfill its function? Delight was whether it gave pleasure. Now there are other criteria you can add in. I mean, is it sustainable? How does it deal with its context? But Vitruvius is still, you know, those are still pretty good criteria. So when I look at a gate, you know, when I look at a gate, that's how I see it. Especially through the, I would add, to firmness, commodity, and delight, its urban function, especially, you know, when it's in a city. But I mean, you know, there can be gates in there. I mean, think of farms. Farms have gates, you know, for penning in livestock. And some of the most iconic gates are the gates of farms, you know, like the Double D Ranch, or, you know, those are, again, those are symbols of belonging. They're really powerful. They are rustic in their simplicity, you know, but they have this kind of wonderful beauty to them, and that beauty is never accidental. There's someone, a blacksmith, you know, who someone designed it, and a blacksmith who made it. So yeah, you need good architecture, you need good clients, We also need good contractors, good builders. So, yes.
I'm curious whether in your research, especially with communities like subdivisions,
right.
if gates sometimes encourage sameness and people inside of them.
Sameness?
So what I mean is, there's like, what I'm thinking of is this new idea and some kind of like multi-use streets
right.
with less signage.
Right.
Drivers pay less attention when there's a lot of signage and when they're used to not showing the road with bikers
right.
and pedestrians.
Right.
So when you get rid of that, the people are actually more safe. And so I'm wondering if, like, in a community that doesn't have gates, people are more attentive, and, you know, like, there's maybe a neighborhood watch team or something, whereas a gated community would feel kind of like they rely on the gate for this.
For safety. Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I mean, so the question is, do the presence of gates make people inside gated communities kind of dull and less?
I wondered if you found actual evidence.
Yeah, so I haven't. You know, the Washington Post column that I showed about Trayvon Martin, you know, Trayvon Martin was shot in a gated community. So in other words, like there was, the guy who wrote that column was making the argument that Gates created this us versus them. But I mean, I think it's, one could speculate, and I don't have empirical research, but this would be a good thesis, you know, for someone to write to compare whether your thesis is true. And I would argue that it would be, because there's less diversity, there's less traffic, there's less action on this. I mean, in a gated community, a street typically is just where there's no sidewalk, at least in the one where my grandmother lived, there wasn't. You know, you just walked around the road and it was kind of like, and it was all sorts of, you know, just a bunch of trees and houses and shuffleboard courts and pools, and it was really kind of boring, right? Have you all read like Jane Jacobs' Death and Life of America, you know, Great American Cities? So, you know, one of her big ideas, right, is eyes on the street. And, you know, you got to have a street there to have eyes on with lots of action. And she talked about the ballet of city life. So in a gated community, I don't think there's much of a ballet because the ballet is all about vectors of circulation. You know, people going this way, that way, that way, and, you know, not running into each other, and the diversity and the color and the variety and the smells. And, you know, in a gated community, it's all sort of like a monotone. It's all like everyone's, you know, same income level, you know, probably the same color. It's so boring, right? So, I mean, you know, so I bet you're right, but I can't prove it.
Maybe in addition to that, you're part of your thesis of like the positive kind of pull that gates have, they're not just, you know, gating entrance, they kind of draw, and especially with the gated community, it means like there's wealth behind it, so like
there's wealth behind
it. Well, it would maybe
right.
say that to like a potential like, thief.
Right.
So it almost makes someone more vulnerable because it shows the importance.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, that's interesting. Sure. I mean, like, so I live in Wilmette, which is, you know, on the North Shore. I live on what's called the Lower East Side of Wilmette. I don't live in a mansion or anything, but when I ride my bike up Sheridan Road, you know, there are all these, like, mansions, and they do have gates. And so the gates proclaim, in a way, you know, I am rich, I am important, and, you know, keep out of my property. So, yes, if you want to signify that you're, you know, rich and important, you know, you can put up a sign with 20-foot high letters on your building, or you can put up a gate. So yes, that might be, create some danger. Yeah. But as Jane Jacobs always said, you know, the safety of cities was the notion of eyes on the street. You know, if streets are active, full of people, well lit, you know, at least in the Greenwich Village that she wrote about, you were safe. Now, you might not be safe in, you know, the west side of Chicago, in a neighborhood like Austin, or there are eyes on the street there too, but, you know, there are also just, you know, awful gangs, and it's a different situation. Anybody else? Yeah.
Wait, I mean, isn't this the ultimate gate community? I mean, there are people who have not gotten tenure at Harvard who have left those gates with this profound seeming depression that's meant all the students have never got in.
Right.
And so, and Princeton, I think it's a McKinney gate as well.
Yeah.
When Cram designed it, he said, this is a walled city against materialism and all its works. I mean, this was...
this is at Princeton?
Yeah. Uh-huh. And what happened in the last 1969, forced it open permanently as this kind of defiance of that. But
right.
Come on, it's Princeton. It's nevertheless this incredibly exclusive community. You can open it all you want within these
right.
boundaries.
Right.
So I'm wondering, you know, as you said, presentation about gates, but if they can't be closed like the word occupy,
right.
do they mean anything?
If they can't be closed?
I'm wondering, everything you're saying about gates is so beautiful.
Uh-huh.
But they are presuming that there's something to be protected, and there are occasions when.
Yeah. So in other words, basically, like, am I going too easy on gates and just saying that they're beautiful and I've romanticized them and, you know. Okay. So I don't think there's any question that Harvard gates were built to to encircle and to protect the yard from the tumultuous transformation of Boston. And Cambridge that was occurring. Remember, I mean, this was this, you know, the whole idea is just like at your campus, everybody wants to be on a campus that's quiet, that's pastoral, and Harvard Yard is like that. And if you imagine Harvard Yard without its enclosure, without the fences and the gates, the noise of Harvard Square would seep in and kind of wreck the contemplative environment that is created. I mean, that it's like the cellular, it's like the cell, the membrane around the cell. It allows what's inside the cell to have this kind of integrity and identity that it would lack otherwise, right? So that edge, that urban edge that's created by the gates and the fence is very important in defining what's inside of it, okay? Now, okay, that's still very positive, right? So, I mean, yes, there's no doubt that if you didn't get into Harvard, if you didn't get tenure, if, you know, the admissions office dinged you with a letter, that you feel like, yeah, those gates are symbols of elitism. Those jerks, they won't let me in, right? And they're symbols of privilege and elitism. And, you know, I hate those guys. And in a democratic world, there should be no gates. I mean, that's sort of the kind of Jeffersonian, like, you know, we should just have grids that go endlessly, you know, and everyone's equal and everyone's a farmer and, you know, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, so I think that what I've tried to say is that there's an ambiguous beauty to them and that they do restrict and they do control. That is unmistakable. But I think the way that, I mean, it's almost like politically correct, and I hate to say that, to view gates in that way. And if we're blind to the positives, we're really cheating ourselves. Because so many people, like, you know, Harvard students, you know, I gotta go to class, I gotta write a paper, they rush through these gates, they never look at them. And, you know, and like, you know, you just, and this is, another thing I would just suggest, stop, you know, pause, behold, look at what these kind of quiet pieces accomplish in terms of creating an edge, you know, signifying the values of the institution, veritas, you know, Christo et ecclesias, veritas, right? You can see Harvard's Christian roots and the way they were transformed. You can see how the university evolved. So they are bearers of identity, like all gates are. And it's a double-edged beauty. That's, you know, like a sword. So yeah, I probably romanticized them a little, sure. But that's because I love them. And, but as a journalist, I have to always keep in mind they're, you know, what they are, those facts on the ground. They restrict, they control. Fair enough?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right, one more question, and then it's probably, you know, time to find out who the next president's gonna be. Yes.
I was just curious, because obviously the gates and stuff like that, you're talking about how they can be welcoming and an entrance for people and
right.
a way to draw people in.
Right.
But you were also talking about how like quadrilateral like campuses usually
right.
have their buildings facing in. And
right.
I was curious if you thought that architects have a responsibility to make their buildings seem inviting as well and not rely on the gates.
Yeah, absolutely. So, the question is, many campuses turn inward to their quadrangles. Do architects have a responsibility not to turn their backs to the street, but to make their buildings seem welcoming? And the answer is absolutely. Today, in fact, I was at the University of Chicago looking at a new dorm complex of three buildings designed by Jeannie Gang, who's a famous Chicago architect. And her buildings form a gateway, a passageway into the campus from the Hyde Park neighborhood. And it's really interesting because we were talking about the building that was there before, the building that was there on where this dorm complex is now was a tower by Harry Weiss, a very good Chicago architect, and it turned its back on the campus. It rose up and it had the trash cans in back of it, and that was the way it met the corner of 55th and University. So I mean, that's pretty, right? That's about as clear as you can get when you're turning, you know, your back to the city. You know, we're going to put our trash cans out here. You know, forget it. So Jeannie has completely reversed that. She's designed these three buildings that they're kind of like, you know, bars, and as in like thin bars. And they form a passageway, you know, like they're like this. And you'll see it in the paper on Sunday when I review it. It's a gateway. It's a gateway, not a gate. So it's clearly meant to be welcoming. There's a plaza there, there's other things there, and this forms an entrance, you know, into the university. Unfortunately, it's also a bit of a wind tunnel, because when you do two buildings like but she did the right thing. Yes.
It was interesting, though, because that building that was torn down, to me, like much of the UIC campus,
right.
symbolizes a period of the 60s of wild mobs. And so
right.
they built buildings with ground floor windows that were like this wide.
Yes.
And, you know, so
the question is,
conditions at the time.
Right, exactly. And that's why I said, everything reflects the circumstances of the time in which it was built. So the question is about the 1960s. There were riots by students and others. And so dorms were built like to be riot-proof, mm-hmm. right? So the students couldn't take them over. And entire campuses were built that way. So for example, I mean, the University of Illinois Chicago campus was known as Fortress Illini. That was the nickname of it. And you know, it was meant like there were all these brutal concrete buildings, and Walter Netsch was the designer, and of course he would never say that it was Fortress Illini. He thought it was like an agora and a place where you gathered. But all that stuff happened inside the campus, and it was kind of keeping, you know, the city at bay. And Jeannie's dorms are completely different. They are inviting the city to pass through, not just at that one gateway, but at any number of other points. So already this is a dorm that's been open only since September 17th, so that's what, less than 10 days. And there are all these people crossing through, da 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 da. And so there is that ballet of a campus that you see instantly. I mean, it's beautiful, it's really amazing to see. So, and partly that occurs because of the way that the gateways funnel movement. It isn't just, you know, like a atomistic with all these, you know, people all over. There is like a crossroads and an order to the, not a restrictive order, but a beautiful order that enlivens, you know, just and makes the everyday movement of passage from one part of a campus to another a beautiful thing. And that's really what I'm talking about, that, you know, these little quiet structures, gates, are part of a larger order that can create, you know, beauty and delight in our everyday world. So that's why, you know, that's why I think they're relevant. And that's probably a good place to stop. So thank you all very much. It was really a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.